to Voice of Israel, Jerusalem.
In our turn to Kol Yisrael, broadcasting from Jerusalem, the Gulf War has begun. Around 2 a.m. this morning, Israel time, huge waves of U.S. and Allied forces bombers struck at targets inside Iraq. President George Bush, 3 hours ago.
As I report now, air attacks are underway against military targets in Iraq. We will deploy the Nasser Saddam Hussein's nuclear bomb potential. We will also destroy the chemical defense facility. Much of Saddam's artillery and tanks will be destroyed. Our operations are designed to best protect the lives of all the coalition forces by targeting Saddam's vast military arsenal. Initial reports from General Schwarzschild are that our operations are proceeding according to plan. Our objectives are clear. Saddam Hussein's forces will leave Kuwait. The legitimate government of Kuwait will be restored to its rightful place. And Kuwait will once again be free. Iraq will eventually comply with all relevant United Nations resolutions, and then, when peace is restored, it is our hope that Iraq will live as a peaceful and cooperative member of the family of nations, thus enhancing the security and stability of the Gulf.
President Bush in a broadcast to the American people at 4 o'clock this morning. Good morning. I'm Tzvi Pantanowitz with Morning News Report on the U.S. attack on Iraq. Since 2 our time this morning, the Allied bombers in the Gulf, spearheaded by American forces, have been pounding Iraqi forces. The targets are Baghdad, where Saddam Hussein is reported to be hiding out, and strategic objectives inside Iraq. Here in Israel, the Civil Defense Authority has announced a wartime economy footing. Only people in essential services are to go to work, and the others are advised to stay at home. Open their gas masks, but not to put them on. Not to put them on. More on this in a moment. The objective of the American strike is understood to be disruption of Iraqi communications and command facilities and to neutralize arsenals of chemical weapons and knock out air bases and missile sites. No plane was reportedly hit. U.S. correspondents quoting administration sources say the Iraqi air force of some 700 planes has been decimated, as have been all the non-conventional arsenals, the chemical and other warfare sites, and missile sites. And this is said to include the H-2 and H-3 air bases on the west side of Iraq, where the missiles pointed in Israel's direction are supposed to be situated. These reports have not been confirmed, I repeat, not been confirmed, and analysts here and in Washington are advising caution. On the line from Washington, we asked Connie Lawn for an assessment of the Pentagon's concerns at this stage.
The main concerns appear to have been met. Washington at this hour is delighted that the operation appears to be going so well. There are no reports of any Iraqi resistance. There's fear that Iraq will launch something that's totally unexpected, that they will still have some chemical or biological capability, or that they will have some nuclear capability. Again, reports today that they had so-called dirty nuke, a nuclear weapon which is primitive, but which can certainly kill a number of people by radiation. That's the major concern. But at this point, the Pentagon is delighted, and if it goes this way, the Pentagon believes the whole thing can be wrapped up in 10 days. And there's a great deal of joy in many quarters in the United States that Israel apparently has been spared any chemical attack. Now, of course, there's the fear of terrorism, and a terrorist reprisal could take place at any time against anyone in the world.
What about the opposition to the war inside the United States?
There is opposition. There are demonstrations in front of the White House. There are demonstrations.
Even now?
Yes, small groups of demonstrators.
Now, it seems that the basic thrust of this campaign now is to wipe out totally the non-conventional infrastructure of the Iraqi armed forces. Is this correct?
The Bush administration is determined to wipe out all of the Iraqi military. And again, they said for the past few weeks that was one of their goals. If Saddam Hussein withdrew from Kuwait, the Iraqi military would be spared destruction. But if he did not, it would be destroyed.
When, if at any time, will there be any ground action? Is there any indication of this?
Not yet. And what the U.S. hopes is that the ground action will take place in another 2 or 3 days. And they hope at that point it will just be a mopping up option just to go through Kuwait and make sure that all the Iraqi soldiers have been driven out. Of course, there won't be much left of Kuwait at that point, but it's been virtually destroyed anyway, even though the oil is still there.
Connie Lawn from Washington. A short time ago, Saddam Hussein came on the air in Iraq, apparently on the only radio frequency operating. First reports say his speech was filled with religious sentiment and spoke of the fatal battle that has begun against the infidel. He said the task of the armed forces was to free Palestine, the Golan, and Lebanon. Saddam told his people that the mother of all battles had started after what he termed Satan Bush had committed his crime. He ended with the words, Allahu Akbar, God is great. And Baghdad Radio was off the air for the first few hours of the conflict, but then broadcast a message saying victory was near. It probably was the first war to be announced live on television from the target. Several American correspondents are in Baghdad. They've been sending a series of dramatic reports, including the sound of bombs falling. CNN has two correspondents in a central Baghdad hotel. That was John Holliman this morning. Also there is Peter Barnett of CNN, who normally is based in Israel.
What seemed to have happened about 20 minutes ago, the anti-aircraft weapons in the city center where we are living around the government buildings erupted in fire. There must have been 200 guns firing into the sky. We did not see any aircraft around, but we did hear the alarm siren.
CNN in Baghdad. An emergency situation has not been declared in Israel, but soon after the start of the war, the Civil Defense Authority instructed everyone to stay in their homes and to open their protective kits. Reporter Alan Ben-Ami spoke this morning to Major General Yaakov Lapidot, the Defense Minister's advisor on the home front, on the situation now and what the public should do.
We ask the population to stay at home, open the boxes of the gas mask, and to listen to the radio and to the television to our messages to them.
At this point, is there any necessity to go into the sealed rooms that have been prepared or to put on gas masks?
No, not at all. What we ask is to remain at home, to stay indoors, and to be prepared with the gas masks, but not to use them if the radio and the television will tell the public to use them, then we'll have to use them. But this is not the situation right now.
And what about people who feel that they have to travel, perhaps to get home from work? They may have stayed there, been on night work, or people who want to move from one house to neighbors or to relatives somewhere. Will this be permitted? Are you closing off the roads? Are there any limitations?
Well, no, the roads are not closed, but the people are asked to stay at home. Only those that are working in factories and other installations that know that they are under emergency regulations are going to work and uses their transportation and their own cars to go and to come back after the work.
And what about the protective kits, the gas masks which they have received? Do they take with them
the gas masks to work and for work?
While asking people to remain at home, to remain indoors, when will they know that it's safe to come out? Or alternatively, that in fact the danger has increased and that they should move into the sealed rooms they've prepared?
The situation assessment is going on all the time. And as far as we will have information that the situation is so that we can free the people from homes, we will let them know. So far we are taking the precautions, safety precautions to remain at home until we will know exactly that those base missiles have been destroyed.
General Yaakov Lapidot. And we've received this announcement for U.S. citizens in the country. And we've received this announcement for U.S. citizens in the country.
In view of the situation in the region, the Department of State advises American citizens in Israel and the territories to pay close attention to media reports and to follow closely instructions issued by Israeli civil defense authorities. The United States Embassy in Tel Aviv and the Consulate General in Jerusalem will be open during normal business hours to provide services to American citizens to the extent circumstances permit.
Don Kaufman of the U.S. Embassy in Tel Aviv. Prime Minister Shamir, the Premier, we understand, was not taken by surprise at the American attack. He had previously been apprised by Washington of the impending U.S. move. On the official Israeli reaction to what has been happening, over to our political affairs reporter, Jack Castanel.
The Foreign Ministry spokesman, Yossi Amihud, issued a statement early this morning saying, although Israel is not involved in this conflict, we follow very closely the unfolding events. I wish the American and coalition forces Godspeed and full success in achieving their missions. I hope that all of them will come home safely, the statement says. Apart from that, officials in Jerusalem are saying nothing on the record and are refusing to give interviews. But I sense the measure of relief over the success of the American airstrikes and the apparent removal of the Iraqi missile threat to Israel, and at the fact that Israel has so far managed to keep out of the conflict. By and large, Israeli leaders have been taking events very calmly. Prime Minister Shamir and Foreign Minister Levy were not at their offices during the night. They were at their Jerusalem residences. The Prime Minister was informed by telephone that the American airstrikes had begun. Deputy Foreign Minister Benjamin Netanyahu, on the other hand, spent the night at the Situation Room at the Foreign Ministry, receiving reports on the progress of the American assault from abroad and also from Israel's own sources of intelligence. Jack Katzenel, Jerusalem.
And a total curfew has been imposed on the territories. There were isolated disturbances in East Jerusalem earlier this morning. Mark Weiss reports.
A curfew was already in force on the whole of the Gaza Strip and on widespread areas of Judea and Samaria. With the outbreak of hostilities in the Gulf, a total curfew was imposed throughout the territories. Soldiers have been ordered to strictly enforce the curfew and prevent Palestinian residents from leaving their homes. Military jeeps patrol the streets with loudspeakers, announcing that residents breaking the curfew are putting their lives in danger. In a number of places, loudspeakers from mosques announced the beginning of war, along with calls of Allahu Akbar, God is great. The news of the war was also spread from home to home by word of mouth. A number of groups over the last few weeks have urged resistance and acts of solidarity with Iraq if war breaks out, the strongest call coming from the Popular Front terror group. However, the authorities have made it crystal clear that any disturbances will be dealt with firmly. In the East Jerusalem village of Silwan and in the Shuafat refugee camp north of the capital, there were clashes involving masked activists early this morning. Curfews have been imposed on both these areas. In other Arab areas of Jerusalem, residents have been prevented from leaving their villages and neighborhoods. Mark Weiss reporting.
And Defense Minister Moshe Arens is speaking at this hour. He's just spoken on television and radio. With me is our political reporter, Jack Atzenel. Jack, what did the Defense Minister say?
Defense Minister Arens said he has been following developments in the Gulf throughout the night. Israel continues to support U.S. policy in the Gulf. Israel's policy has been restrained and responsible, Arens said. And the Israeli public had behaved in an exemplary manner, which had aroused admiration and served as an example to the world. The Defense Minister warned it is too early to say that the danger to Israel from Iraq has passed, and therefore Israel and the Israeli public must continue to take precautions for the present.
Jack Atzenel. Now to sum up the home front advice to our listeners, here's Sarah Manovla.
As you heard, the civil defense authorities have instructed all civilians who are not engaged in essential services to remain at home. The gas mask kits should be opened, the filter inserted, the head strap adjusted, and the gas mask kept to hand. There's no need at this point to make use of the sealed rooms. Further instructions will be given throughout the day as required on television and radio. Kol Yisrael's Hebrew networks and the Army network have combined. Kol Yisrael's English broadcast will be carried simultaneously on shortwave and on Reshet Aleph Network 1 on 576 and 1458 kilohertz. At the usual time, with two additional broadcasts, at 9 a.m. and at 3:45, the usual broadcast times at 1 and 8 p.m.
Sarah Manobla, thank you. A quick jump to the main points. American and Allied air forces early this morning attacked Iraqi air bases and other strategic targets throughout Iraq. All reports from the Gulf say the Allied coalition already has complete control of the skies and has already begun attacking Iraqi ground forces, and Iraqi missile launchers aimed at Israel are reportedly destroyed. That's all from News Report for now. Now the news in French. Good morning and shalom from Jerusalem.
It's proving rather difficult to get through to Moscow, but on the line now I'm joined from New York by Alexander Shalnev of the Soviet government newspaper Izvestia. Mr. Shalnev, have you had any reaction from Moscow about the developments overnight in the Gulf?
No, we don't have anything as yet. I presume there would be some kind of reaction later this day. But I understand that before the invasion, or rather the attack took place, the Secretary of State, Mr. James Baker, was in touch with the new Foreign Minister of the Soviet Union, Mr. Besmertnev, informing him about what was coming. So it was not at all a surprise for the Soviet Union what happened last night.
What have you been reporting back so far to Moscow from what's been happening in New York and Washington?
I didn't report much. I report something on what was going on at the United Nations, because I understand there was a statement made by the Secretary General of the United Nations, Pérez de Cuellar, who expressed his deep regret about what happened. And actually, I was reporting as well that there is no role as such for the United Nations to play at the moment, because, I mean, the United Nations has to stand on the outline waiting for the final outcome of the attack on Iraq.
Mr. Charlotte, thank you very much indeed for joining us here on the BBC World Service. And here in the studio, I have an assembly of Middle East experts, and they include Peter Mansfield, who's an author and writer. Peter, one of the striking developments so far seems to be perhaps most strikingly noted in Japan, a sense of relief. Now, there the stock markets, as we understand, have actually gone up. Is there, do you think, a widespread sense of relief that at last the conflict has broken out, paradoxical as that may seem?
No, I think that this is certainly one element. After all, the crisis has lasted nearly 6 months. Everybody's been deeply tense, everyone connected with it. I can understand that, but I think also the sense of relief must be largely because the expected attack on Israel has not taken place, and nor any attack on Saudi Arabia.